Pirates, what are they? Where do they come from? How did they change the course of history? And how are they relevant to your daily life? Well, even in this day and age, piracy costs the global economy a total of $18 billion annually. Modern piracy affects both tourism and fishing. It forces shippers to change trading routes and partially fueled the drop in fish exports by 23.8% since 2006. The most affected countries include Comoros, Djibouti, Kenya, Mozambique, Madagascar, Mauritius, the Seychelles, Somalia, Tanzania, Yemen, Pakistan, and other Middle Eastern countries. There have been 1,068 Somali pirate attacks since January of 2005, including 218 successful hijackings, $53 million demanded and paid, and between 82 and 97 casualties. But to really understand pirates and how they affect you every day, let's take it back to the start. While piracy has changed dramatically as the world has modernized, pirates have had a major effect on the United States foreign policy, as well as the global economy. Today we're here with the infamous pirate Blackbeard, originally known as Edward Teach. He has covered his face for security purposes. Blackbeard, when was the golden age of piracy?
The golden age of piracy was back in the 18th century, in my time. It's romanticized today through pirates like Captain Hook and, of course, me.
Why was it called this?
Because of me, of course. In the early 1700s, I captured merchant vessels in the Caribbean and the Atlantic. In 1718, I raided Charleston, South Carolina, seized many ships, and demanded a ransom for several high-class prisoners. Later that year, I was killed in a battle with the British Navy. I gained power from terrorization rather than violence.
The Revolution coincided with a golden age of privateering, and so the U.S. got involved with pirates during the years leading up to the Revolution. Early on, the Continental Congress passed laws to issue letters of marque. Letters of marque were licenses to fit out an armed vessel and use it in the capture of enemy merchant shipping and to commit acts that would otherwise have constituted as piracy. An early success for the colonists came when the Lee, George Washington's commissioned privateer, captured a British ship and its cache of much-needed arms, including a cannon that was renamed the Congress. Even before the French formally allied themselves with the Americans, their privateers raided English shipping, storming aboard British ships. When the Revolution ended, hostilities continued between the French and English for several decades. Both sides, fearing that American merchant ships were trading with the enemy, sent privateers to harass them. Tensions rose, culminating in the War of 1812.
Today we're here with Jean Lafitte, a French pirate during the early 19th century. Lafitte, when was your heyday as a pirate and a privateer?
During and after the War of 1812, I operated from the island of Barataria, near New Orleans. I plagued American authorities with my raids on merchant ships and my evasion of the tariff, the main source of federal funds at the time. Officials feared that I would ally myself with the English.
Did you ally yourself with any country?
The British did try to recruit me, but I declined to join them. After the Americans destroyed my nest on Barataria, I offered my services to General Andrew Jackson in return for a presidential pardon. My intimate knowledge of the bayous at the mouth of the Mississippi helped Jackson devise his winning strategy at the Battle of New Orleans. After my pardon, I went back to pirating.
And what was your legacy as a pirate?
In time, my story and those of other historical pirates were romanticized in books like Robert Louis Stevenson's Treasure Island, by films such as The Buccaneer, and by hunters of buried treasure and shipwrecks.
Now we are here with Thomas Jefferson, third president of the United States. Thomas Jefferson, what were your experiences with pirates?
Well,
the North African states of Algeria, Morocco, Tunis, and Tripoli sanctioned sea raiders called the Barbary Pirates to attack ships of other nations in the Mediterranean Sea. In 1801, the countries asked me, racist Thomas Jefferson, to make a large payment to protect U.S. shipping from piracy. I obviously refused, and so the Pasha of Tripoli declared war on May 14, 1801, and began seizing American ships.
What did you do in response?
Well, the U.S. blockaded Tripoli, but this had no effect. Diplomatic negotiations didn't seem to be working either, so the U.S. returned to making tribute payments in order to protect their citizens.
When did you start fighting back, Thomas Jefferson?
In 1803, the U.S. suddenly began fighting back in what became known as the Tripolitan War. The U.S. forces, led by Commander Edward Preble and Lieutenant Stephen Decatur, engaged in many skirmishes with the Barbary pirates, a few involving the U.S. frigate Philadelphia.
What was the major U.S. victory in the war?
It was centered around the capturing of the port city of Derna by William Eaton, the U.S. consul to Tunis. He planned on replacing the Tripolitan Pasha with the rightful ruler. Eaton and his troops marched to Derna from Egypt, where they attacked Tripoli with the help of the U.S. Navy. The conflict at Derna would later be remembered in the U.S. Marine hymn, "From the Halls of Montezuma to the Shores of Tripoli." Instead of unseating the Pasha, in June 1805, a peace agreement was reached that allowed the U.S. to cease paying tributes to Tripoli. However, the rest of the Barbary states would keep receiving tribute payments all the way until 1816.
Piracy isn't just overseas, though. Piracies interrupted American life within the country. River piracy in the late 18th, mid-19th century America mainly occurred along the Ohio River and Mississippi River valleys. In 1803, at Tower Rock, the U.S. Army Dragoons, possibly from the Frontier Army post upriver at Fort Kaskaskia on the Illinois side opposite St. Louis, raided and drove out the river pirates. Stack Island was also associated with river pirates and counterfeiters in the late 1790s. In 1809, the last major river pirate activity took place on the upper Mississippi River, and river piracy in this area came to an abrupt end when a group of flat boatmen raided the island, wiping out the river pirates. From 1790 to 1834, Cavern Rock was the principal outlaw lair and the headquarters of river pirate activity in the Ohio River region, from which Samuel Mason led a gang of river pirates on the Ohio River. River piracy continued on the lower Mississippi River from the early 1800s to the mid-1830s, declining as a result of direct military action and local law enforcement and regulator vigilante groups that uprooted and swept out pockets of outlaw resistance.
The Washington Conference of 1922 on the Limitation of Armaments agreed that the general international law of war forbade the destruction of a merchant ship unless the crew and passengers have been first placed in safety, and specifically affirmed that this rule applied to belligerent submarines.
On February 20th, 1928, 20 Latin American states, plus the United States, signed 24 piracy agreements at the Havana Convention on Civil Strife. Article 2 of that convention says, "The declaration of piracy against vessels which have risen in arms, emanating from a government, is not binding upon the other states."
A third recent international convention dealing with acts done outside of a belligerency context which endanger international civil aviation is the Convention for the Suppression of Unlawful Acts Against the Safety of Civil Aviation, concluded in Montreal on the 23rd of September, 1971.
Today, pirates may not be as relevant to your life, but they do affect your country's economy and others.
Thanks for watching!
Now you know exactly how heavily pirates affected U.S. history.